Nightmare to see that speed and ability coming at you.
His shot was incredible.
Probably the greatest defenseman to ever lace on a pair of skates.
He was the greatest hockey player I ever saw, and since 1936, right through to 55, I saw a lot of him.
The greatest hockey player who ever lived, Bobby Orr, and I love him.
Sanderson a drive, and that one whistled wide. Ory for the Bruins, tied up by Ecclestone and Berenson. Westfall rolled it in front. Sanderson tried a shot that was wide and keen and cleared a buck not out. Bobby Orr behind the net to Sanderson. Orr! Bobby Orr scores, and the Boston Bruins have won the Stanley Cup. Orr slipping it in with a close goal. And look at the long team by the Bruins. Another look in behind the net to Sanderson, out in front to Orr, and Bobby Orr made no mistake in beating Glenn Hall.
If a picture represents a thousand words, this famous shot represents a thousand amazing feats in the career of the hockey player most considered the best to ever lace up a pair of skates, the incomparable Bobby Orr. Hello, I'm Ron Hewitt. It was a sad day for hockey when Bobby Orr officially announced his retirement from active play on November the 8th, 1978. From the outset, he proved himself a leader, winning the Calder Memorial Trophy in his rookie NHL season, followed by numerous honors, including 8 consecutive James Norris Memorial Trophies, 3 Hart Trophies, 2 Art Ross Trophies, 2 Conn Smythe Trophies, the Pearson Trophy, the Lester Patrick Award, and the Lou Marsh Trophy as top Canadian athlete in 1970. And along the way, he scored more goals and more points than any defenseman in NHL history. And he also led the Boston Bruins to 2 Stanley Cup championships in 1970 and 1972. Now, for the next 80 minutes, we're going to relive some of the best moments of Bobby Orr's outstanding National Hockey League career through selected game action highlights, comments, and observations from other celebrated individuals in the world's fastest game. You'll see how the young kid from Parry Sound, Ontario, became a hockey legend.
Clarence Campbell, the president of the National Hockey
League. It took 29 years and Bobby Orr to bring Stanley Cup mania to Boston, yet Bobby had been in the NHL just 4 years and his legend was still growing.
The Bruins have won the Stanley Cup for the first time in 29 years. Jusek brings that cup down to the other end of the ice. He wants all the fans to have a look at it.
In an injury-shortened 12-year Hall of Fame career, he lifted the game of hockey to new heights, changed it forever. He was the first defenseman to become a consistent offensive threat, controlling the game like no other before him, and no other since. Bobby Orr did it all. Skate with supernatural speed and grace. Pass with uncanny precision. Shoot with rifle-like accuracy and howitzer power. Defend with tenacious courage. And hit like a truckload of bricks. Number 4, Bobby Orr was the best. A man whose outstanding talent remade the game of hockey and garnered many honors. None more satisfying than these words from other hockey legends.
When Bobby came into the game, he became a rushing defenseman. He became a goal scorer. Point getter. He just opened the game right up to more offense, and that's the way the game is played now.
Overall, I can very safely say Bobby impressed me more than anybody with his tremendous talents.
He's the best player that ever went through here in my 26, 27 years as coach, manager, etc.
He would drive to the net injured, he would drive to the net hurt. He played that way every night.
Well, the first thing that usually when I see Orr coming down at me and that, I'd probably try and say a little prayer if I had time.
I think the greatest change in hockey would be the arrival of Bobby, and it's the mobility of defensemen.
He never lost sight of the fact that he had played minor hockey. He was a youngster that asked for autographs. He always had time for people around him.
Bobby Orr was the greatest defenseman that ever played in a game, as far as I'm concerned. And I think I believe this in my heart, he changed the face of the game.
What do you call a man who transforms skating skill into an ice ballet? What do you call a man who seemed to know what an opponent was going to do before he did it?
Gets away from Hextall. On the move, Bobby Orr. Gets by Sather. Killing off the clock.
What do you call a man who played with supreme courage? What do you call a man who played for his teammates and his team, never for himself?
Back to Orr breaking. Orr.
What do you call a man who took an old game and remade it for a modern era? What do you call a man who redefined the meaning of grace under pressure?
Gets by Ron Harris. Orr's got the puck. Cuts through. Fires. Goal!
What do you call a man who now sits at the highest level among the heroes of hockey?
The open man is Sanderson. Takes the pass. Right in front. A quick goal by Bobby Orr.
What do you call a man who has become a legend in everybody's eyes but his own? You call him Bobby Orr. The boy from the small Ontario town who became a giant in the world's fastest, toughest game.
Bobby picks up speed as he swings the net. Gets by one man, ahead for Derek Sanderson. Sandy, to Lorenz, out front, shot at the post, and it's tied up right at the post. Out to Esposito. Back to Orr. In the corner, Stanfield. Back to Orr. Fakes a shot, pulls it around Nestorenko. Going in, his shot. Bounces over the net. Stanfield trying to work it back to Esposito. Orr has it. Gets it on his forehand. He drives. Wide of the net. McKenzie. Looking. Working his way in. His shot. Flat. Goes out to Esposito. He fires. Stopped by Tony Esposito and he hangs on. Busick to Orr. He drives. Stopped off by Busick. Goal!
Mullins ahead for Bobby Hull. Bobby Orr back in the Boston zone on the loose puck. Kept in by the Chicago Blackhawks and Gotti.
Runs right into Orr and down he goes.
Across to Orr. Orr shifts on Holgerson. Back through. Shot.
And here comes Orr. He's got running room. Pass to Esposito. Goal! It's 5-1. And Esposito has scored his second goal of the night, his 17th of the year. Bobby Orr picks up his second assist.
Puck is loose. McKenzie has it. 45 seconds left to the penalty to Bergman. Orr fires. Goal!
Cashman as the Bruins start up. Bobby Orr up to Hyde. Back to Orr. His shot. Time of Bobby's goal comes at 2:10.
Orr breaks out with Sanderson. 2-on-1. Reed is back. He's got Sanderson with him. Holds it to Sanderson. Back to Orr. Empty net goal.
Russo. Ball out by New York here. Nobody in their net. Drive by Park goes wide. Orr. Long shot. And it scores.
Parry's Sound isn't exactly the center of the hockey universe. But it didn't take long for the hockey world to notice a young phenom named Bobby Orr. Ren Blair is known for his abilities in discovering and nurturing hockey talent, especially for the Boston Bruins. He knew right away that Bobby Orr was special.
When I first saw him play in a Bantam playoff game in Gananoque, and Lynn Patrick and Weston Adams, the owner of the Bruins, and Hap Ems and Harold Cotton, Milt Schmidt, all came down to our playoffs and stayed there all week. And I had told Lynn on a Friday night, there were a couple of kids on the Gananoque team I'd been watching, and I asked him if he'd like to go over with me. About 3 minutes into the game, Lynn was standing down at the far end of the corner of the rink, And I walked down to him and I said, you know, forget those two kids in Gananoque that I asked you to come over and see. I said, there's a kid on that Perry Sound team that's out of this world. And he said, that little guy number two on defense, which is the number he wore that day. And I said, yeah, he said, isn't he something? I said, boy, I can't believe this kid. 2 days later, I was in Perry Sound.
Hall of Famer Milt Schmidt was with Wren and the other Boston Brass on that remarkable day.
What a find he was. He was only 12 years old at that time, and you could tell at that particular time that he was, by far and away, one of the best prospects ever in the National Hockey League.
There was no doubt that Bobby Orr would one day play in the NHL. Who he would play for was the question. A big question.
I spent a rather frustrating 2 years waiting for him to become 14. I always joked that during those 2 years that every time Arva came out on the back porch to shake her dust mop, I was sitting on it waiting for Bobby to come home from school. Because I felt that that it was very important to build up a relationship with Bobby.
The Rangers, the Leafs, they were all after Bobby. But Wren Blair was like a terrier. There was no way he'd let go of a future franchise player like Orr.
We used to, in those days, hold junior tryout camps. So that summer, I was able to get Bobby to come down to that camp. He just dazzled everybody.
It was at that camp that future teammate and close friend Derek Sanderson first saw Bobby in action.
I said, how good can he be? He's 129 pounds.
But he was a rocket then. He could fly, he could handle the puck. Gritty. A lot tougher than people ever thought he was.
To get Bobby Orr, the Boston Bruins bankrolled the return of Junior A hockey to Oshawa. Wren Blair convinced the young star and his parents that playing for the Oshawa Generals was the right decision. And Bobby took the first step toward becoming the greatest Boston Bruin in the history of that storied franchise. Bobby, the one thing I know that you've appreciated over the years, because you talk about it so often, is the love and support that you received from your family when you were playing hockey in Perry Sound and had to leave at age 14.
It was difficult. I was very young. I don't know if you've ever been homesick or not, but I can assure you, it's a terrible feeling. That first year was awful.
So now you're going to play Junior A hockey, Bobby. You weigh 126 pounds. You're a young, skinny kid, the youngest of all the members of the team. Did you have to try harder to make the team, to play against the others?
I wasn't really thinking about proving anything. I wanted to make the team. I was going to go there and try my hardest, try to play my best. I was being given an opportunity to play a game that I loved to play, to play a game that I dreamt about playing. From the time I started watching hockey, I could remember the Maple Leafs or the Canadians skating around center ice with that Stanley Cup, and I wanted to be part of a team and do just that.
Jim Peters, a close friend of Bobby's since his early days with the Oshawa Generals, recalls the Phenom's arrival.
Well, I can remember first day of training camp. We'd heard about Bobby Orr before, but when we go on the ice, within 5 minutes when he had the puck, we knew who Bobby Orr was. He was the man.
For 2 years, Bobby's was a road act. The Generals' home games were played at Maple Leaf Gardens and in Bowmanville. But in 1964, with the opening of the new Civic Arena, the people of Oshawa got to see their junior superstar up close. His mentor, Wren Blair, appreciated Bobby's humanitarian qualities off the ice, but on it, he wasn't quite so sure.
I used to get on his case. He'd go through the whole team, go around the net, and then give the puck to some kid who only had 3 goals. You know, and that kid would miss the net half the time. And I would say to him, why do you do that? We're trying to win the game, you know. Well, he says, we're up 6-2 anyway. I mean, what's the matter, you know?
Those who played against Bobby knew how good he was, including future teammate Derek Sanderson, then a center for the Niagara Falls junior team.
We had our goals because I was a defensive centerman, a checking centerman, and Bobby obviously was the offense wherever he went. So my role was to shut him down. And I used to stand in front of the net. I said, no, you can't, no, you can't. And I used to yell at him behind the net, I'll get you. But Bobby was, he was just so fast. He had so many moves. He had that little pirouette move. He'd lead you to believe he was going to move the puck. And he'd look off that way and dish it back in. He could move it, then he would break. You couldn't catch him. And he would get back into a hole. And he was almost unstoppable, as unstoppable as any player I've ever seen.
In Oshawa, Bobby had four great all-star seasons, but his team never won the ultimate prize, the Memorial Cup.
Bobby, it's 1966. You know you're going to the Boston Bruin training camp. It's in London. You're going to play against the big boys now. This is your opportunity to make the National Hockey League. How did you feel?
When I received the invitation to go, obviously I was thrilled. I knew that was the next step. The Bruin training camp to go and see what I could do. I remember going to London to the motel, and I was given a key, and I walked in my room, and there was a player laying on the bed with just his underwear on. His nickname was Buddha. A little bit of a tummy on him, our captain, John Busick. And I remember looking at him and saying, hello, Mr. Busick. And he looked up at me and he says, you don't call me Mr. Busick, you call me John or Chief.
As Bobby Orr arrived on the NHL stage, an era was ending. This was the last season for the original six-team league. Next year, expansion would remake the face of hockey, just as Bobby was about to remake the way the game was played. And when Bobby Orr laced up his skates in his patented barefoot style, he became otherworldly.
I never knew a player before or since that could go from standstill to just flying with about four strides. If anybody had told anybody prior to Bobby, do you know within the next 3 years, a defenseman's going to win the NHL scoring championship, they would look at you like you're out of your mind. And yet, that's what Bobby did. And I don't know if anybody ever will again.
Just 18, not even fully grown. Bobby Orr quickly proved in that amazing 1966-67 season that at any age, any size, he was already a man among men, a man to be reckoned with. The Bruins had missed the playoffs the previous seven seasons, but the young rookie number four quickly turned the team into a contender.
My first game was against Detroit, and Gordie Howe, he was the man. And I can remember in that game, first of all, coming to the rink, I was here at 1 p.m. for a night game. Nervous, excited. This is the next step, and heck, I'm playing a game I love to play, and I'm being paid to do it. And I was just so excited. But I think Gordie wanted to let the kid know that he was still around. I was watching on one play. I was watching my pretty pass, and someone I didn't know at the time, the player that hit me, but it was Gordie. And I think he was trying to give me a little reminder about, hey kid, you've got to keep your head up in this game.
First time I played against him, as a matter of fact, for some reason, maybe he anticipated a comeback of some kind, but he laid the lumber on the back of my head. I turned around and I said, hit that little pimple-faced kid, When I came in and I circled left when he passed the puck, I circled right when he passed the puck, and the third one I didn't circle, I ran over top of him, and all of his old buddies come running to him. And the remark that the young man made said to me, there's a guy not only with tremendous talent, but a great mind. He just simply looked at him and said, gentlemen, relax, I deserve that.
Another legend of the game and one of the great Montreal players and gentlemen of all time, Jean Béliveau, knew he was watching a new game when Orr was on the ice.
He looked so young. I remember our first few games. We all have heard about him, what he did as a junior. And it didn't take long before we realized this great talent, this great natural ability. And as everybody realized very quickly that what a great skater and playmaker he was at the same time.
Jacques Lemaire, then a future star with the league-leading Montreal Canadiens, got an early view of a legend in the making.
Just came up and played like an experienced guy, and he was controlling the game nearly as good as he was with the juniors. When I played, I do remember it was not too many guys that I couldn't catch when I wanted. One guy that I couldn't catch was this guy. You had to go on him in a different way. You had to think about, he's got a lot of moves, he's got speed. He can make you look like a fool, so you had to be careful.
Bobby Orr got a hold of that puck. He got everybody out of their seat. They were on their feet continually. Very exciting player. He really worked at it.
There's what we
never
mean
got the
control.
Marks that he should have had defensively.
Ahead for Bobby Hull.
Sure, he was an offensive defenseman, no doubt about it, but he was always back there when he needed to be. He had the knack of getting back in time to stop the play from going into our zone.
Widening and an open net, or back.
It's true. Bobby redefined the role of the defenseman from pure defender into offensive threat. But Bobby's offense flowed out of a fluid, give-no-quarter defensive ability. In any sport, there are only a select few who are able to see not only what is happening, but what will happen. Bobby Orr was one of that select few.
Orr, he scored!
They talk a lot about peripheral vision in hockey, and Bobby was one of those players that was blessed with excellent vision, where that he would look straight ahead, but he would see behind him. I think he also had a kind of a sensory perception of where other people were. He would look up, make a quick check off, and he'd say, okay, now he knows where everybody is or where they could get to before he moved 7-8 feet. How much could they close in on? And I think he had a feeling of where everybody was. He certainly had a feeling where his teammates were.
Bobby Orr to Sanderson, going in, Sandy.
To create something out of nothing, to see possibilities where others see only chaos, to make a stunning move that no one has ever made before, instinctively, perfectly, a move that brings a roar of appreciation from the crowd and a grunt of disbelief from an opponent. To do these things in the heat of battle, at intense speed, in the midst of flashing blades and bruising bodies, that is art raised to its highest level. Bobby Orr created within the game of hockey the way a Picasso or a Rembrandt created within a field of canvas. And the way we look at the world and the game has never been the same.
Hauled down by Barrett, in for Dusick, score! What a play by Dusick, and Bobby Orr, who's flat on the ice.
I've got to see this one again to believe it. Now you just watch Orr here and Dusick combine for this goal. Orr is down on the ice. Now watch this play here. There's the puck. Now here it comes. And there's Busek cutting in from the left wing, doing what he did just a moment ago, but he caught Gilbert going halfway and he just tucked it between his pads.
I had been a defenseman throughout my career as well, with a very limited skating ability, and had always wished that I could have lugged the puck like I saw this young guy doing it. And everybody could see immediately that this was something from which to build a team style around, and a team, a game plan and a concept and an identity for the type of team you were. And he was just so talented and throughout his career that you could not invoke a system to restrain him. It would have been the most foolish thing anybody could have done.
Bobby learned the lessons of the NHL in an unnatural hurry. In his first year, he scored 41 points and won the Calder Trophy as Rookie of the Year. Scary for the rest of the league when you consider that his best years were still ahead of him.
Bobby, one of the biggest trades occurred in your second year with the Boston Bruins. It shook the team, but it was one of the best moves ever made by Boston Bruin management. And that was the huge trade where Esposito came to the Boston Bruins. Tell me about that as far as your reaction to the trade and how it worked out in the building of the Boston Bruins.
The Bruins had some very good players here. Teddy Green, Dallas Smith, John Busick, Johnny McKenzie. Pretty good hockey players. And then the trade. And that's really what turned. When you can get three players like Stanfield, Esposito, and Hodge that step in. And I don't think anyone, Milt Schmidt made the deal. And I don't think Milt really thought they were going to play like they ended up playing, but they became superstars in this league. So when you can put three players in, mix it with some of your kids, mix it with the veterans that are already here, that was a start. But those three players from Chicago, Esposito, Hodge, and Stanfield, no question, that was a turning point for this team.
In the 1967-68 season, Bobby Orr and a revamped Bruins team made it to the playoffs for the first time in 8 years. Along the way, Bobby Orr collected his first Norris Trophy and second All-Star selection in an injury-reduced season. He also indelibly changed the game with his rushing style.
Over the line, Orr over to Lonsberry.
Bill Waters has had a long-standing personal and business relationship with Bobby.
I often said that when he was on the ice, you were sure of two things. One, that the puck was coming out of your end, automatic. And then when it came out of your own zone, you knew there was going to be a chance on net because Orr was going to create it.
Yes, Bobby was doing so much to elevate the game of hockey and the play of his team. Bobby bled Bruin yellow and black. In 1968-69, he brought them one step closer to Stanley Cup glory.
That 68-69 season was a very important season for us. We learned a lot that, they say about losing? You can learn a lot from losing, and we learned a lot from losing that season, and then the following season we did win the Stanley Cup.
Everywhere you looked that year, number four Bobby Orr was there. In his third NHL season, he was already a cultural icon, a social phenomenon, and the rest of the league was paying very close attention.
There was only one way you could stop Bobby Orr. And every time he was on that ice, the opposition would be playing a man short. They would have to have a man planted on Bobby Orr continually. That would be the only way. And if you went to bed with Bobby, that's the only way you could stop him.
I don't think you ever stopped Bobby Orr. You contained Bobby Orr, but you never stopped him. He was too talented and too great a player to ever stop him. So we tried to contain him, and normally you did that with by sending two and maybe three guys and on him, and you figured that if Bobby gave the puck up, it was a good play.
Terry Crisp is a Perry Sound native like Bobby Orr. He also played against Bobby before beginning a strong career as an NHL coach.
Heading down to the Boston zone, and who was there to look you square in the face and break up the play was Bobby Orr. Who was the first guy down to your end leading the rush? Bobby Orr. Who was the guy making the play from behind the net? Bobby Orr. Bobby Orr was ushering in a new era for defense.
It was the dawn of a new era for hockey, and most especially the Boston Bruins. The end of the 68-69 season saw the Bruins bow out in the Stanley Cup semifinals to the eventual winners, the dynastic Montreal Canadiens. And once again, Bobby Orr garnered the Norris Trophy and an all-star selection. He also upped his scoring total to 64 points on 21 goals and 43 assists. Numbers unheard of for a defenseman.
Gets it out to Orr. He fires. Goal!
But for Bobby and the Bruins, the best was yet to come. Bobby Orr's fourth year in the league was to be one of his greatest. He set new standards for defensemen that may never be equal.
He fires. It's all tied up, and Bobby Orr has set a new National Hockey League record. 65 points. And the tremendous ovation here at a capacity crowd at the Boston Garden continues for young number four, 21-year-old Bobby Orr. And Bobby is visibly affected by this fine round of applause. They appreciate good hockey performances here in Boston. Bobby gets around. Jim Peters still has it from the line. Goal! And that's the record breaker. Bobby Orr has broken the record for most goals in a season by a defenseman. His 22nd goal of the year. Moves it around. Howe up to Sanderson. Back to Orr. All of a sudden, he's got running room. Getting around Harris, putting in, scores! It's 3-2, and Orr has scored a shorthanded goal, his 100th point. That's Bobby Orr's 100th point of the season. No other defenseman in the National Hockey League history has ever done it. Orr gets around Collins. He's got running room. Passes to Westfall. His shot. Goal! It's 4-0 Boston. A new record by Bobby Orr. He's eclipsed Phil Esposito's all-time assist record. And it's a standing ovation here at the Boston Garden for Bobby Orr. No player in the history of the National...
The men who had the best view of this superstar during that momentous season were his coach, Harry Sinden, and teammate Phil Esposito.
He was the game breaker and the game winner for us, whether he scored or whether he didn't score. But in some fashion, if we could keep it close, at the end, Bobby would find a way to help us win it.
Orr was so dominant. I mean, I was so fortunate to be on the team with him. Our power play was awesome because of Bobby. Once we got in their zone, the other team was dead. There's no doubt about it.
Here's Orr at the blue line, holding it in to Phil Esposito. He said he scores! Phil Esposito beats younger brother Tony on a low shot.
With Ken Hodge and Wayne Cashman crashing the boards and opposing players, with Phil Esposito's uncanny hands and unmovable bulk creating mayhem in the slot, and with Bobby Orr providing the electricity, the power, it's small wonder the Bruins became an incredible scoring machine.
Off the stick of Phil Esposito, wide to the far side.
Esposito, Cashman, Hodge, Orr, and Dallas Smith for the Bruins. All set. Here's Don Earl.
And Orr takes the faceoff from Esposito, sneaks by Nielsen, throws it across.
In a five-season span, Orr and Esposito combined to surpass 100 points 10 times, along the way winning a total of 7 scoring titles.
But a key move by Esposito, Orr, and Hodge.
During that period, Phil Esposito also had 5 50-goal seasons, many of those markers set up by the incredible Bobby Orr.
Orr shifts on Lacroix and starts out through center ice. Lead pass, Sanderson going in.
Bobby made every Bruin a better player, and that's the mark of a genius. The Béliveaux have it, the Gretzkys have it, and then there was Bobby Orr.
To Bobby Orr, shot, goal!
When the ice chips had settled at the end of the regular season, Bobby Orr stood above his peers as the first ever defenseman to win the Art Ross Trophy for leading the league in scoring points with 120 on 33 goals and 87 assists. He also picked up the Hart Trophy as the league's most valuable player, along with his 3rd consecutive Norris Trophy and 4th straight All-Star nod. Then the playoffs started, and Bobby Orr moved another step closer to the Hall of Fame with a brilliant performance that culminated in the Bruins' first Stanley Cup in 29 years, and Bobby Orr's selection as the Conn Smythe Trophy winner. Robert Gordon Orr truly was the most valuable player in this remarkable playoff drive. In the quarterfinals, the Bruins paced to the New York Rangers 4-2.
Orr across the line, going in, shot, goal! And the Bruins lead it 1-0. Paquita's shot, the flex off a stick. Cheevers caught it, dropped it. Puck is close in front. Here's Hall at the point. The drive, and Bobby Orr stopped that one. Orr.
The semifinals against the Chicago Blackhawks were even more of a mismatch, with the Bruins soaring on Orr's superlative play, taking the series 4-0 and outscoring the Hawks by 10 goals.
Bobby Orr legs it back up through center ice.
And then in the final, it would be St. Louis's turn. And when he was with St. Louis, Terry Crisp had been touched by the Orr magic.
Scotty Bowman decided one game that Terry Crisp and Jimmy Roberts were going to shadow Bobby Orr. Okay. No, he says, we're going to stop him tonight. Okay, so the game gets going. I think we lost that one maybe 6-2 or 6-3. I'm not sure the score exactly of that one. But Jimmy Roberts and I, we did a great job of shadowing and shutting down Bobby Orr. I mean, I think he only got 1 goal and 5 assists that night.
Bobby Orr starts out slowly, cuts right in front of Jerry Cheevers, feeds Esposito at center ice. Trying to go around Bob Plager in front, blocked by Wakely, out to Stanfield, goal! It's 1-0, the Bruins lead on a power play goal by Freddie Stanfield.
The final series was a tidal wave of black and gold, with Orr leading the way to a 4-game sweep and the Stanley Cup. But with his usual flair for the dramatic, Orr saved his first goal of the series for what became one of the most famous moments in hockey.
I always tell people that I was the one that made him famous. You know, I tell Bobby that. I made you famous.
Sanderson a drive, and that one whistled wide.
Harry Sinden started our line. We were playing well, myself, Westfall, and Wayne Carlton.
And Bobby was playing the point with Donnie Ory, and it was overtime. And we kept the puck in pretty good. We were all over them, really. I had two opportunities to score. Missed the net both times.
Ory for the Bruins, tied up by Ecclestone and Berenson. Westfall rolled it in front, Sanderson.
I knew he was coming. He stayed in at the point, kept the puck in, threw it back around the boards and broke.
Tried a shot that was wide and Keenan cleared to Bakhanov. Bobby Orr behind the net to Sanderson. Orr! Bobby Orr! Scores in the Boston Bruins! Have won the Stanley Cup!
I was so happy for him because he deserved it. You couldn't write the script any better. Bobby had to get that goal in overtime.
You know, you always talk about winning the Stanley Cup, and it's probably the greatest thing for any youngster that wants to play in hockey, come up to win a Stanley Cup. And probably in 1970, when Bobby scored the goal in overtime, you sleep with it. Even now, we just think about it, how he scored that goal and went flying through the air. Probably the happiest moment of my career.
Another look.
For many hockey fans, this picture defines hockey. It was the ultimate goal in a storybook season for the Bruins, and number four.
And the Bruins win the Stanley Cup.
With Stanley Cup rings on their fingers, the Bruins surged into the 1970-71 season with visions of dynasty floating in their heads. Bobby Orr led the charge with a season that may never be equaled.
Kick save, goal! Bobby Orr scores his first goal of the new season.
Back in 1967, Harry Howell, a veteran New York Ranger defenseman, won the Norris Trophy as that year's best rear guard and said at the time, "I might as well enjoy it now because I expect it's going to belong to Bobby Orr for the next 10 years. Bobby did win the Norris for 8 straight years. And if his knees had stayed healthy, who knows, he might still be playing, thrilling crowds and setting records. He had that kind of intensity. The total love for the game that never wavers, never dies. How good was he? Well, it's been said that if you put 5 Orrs against 5 Howes or 5 Gretzkys, the Orrs would win hands down. Because Orr could play at both ends of the ice. He could handle the puck in the offensive zone like a centerman. He had a shot like a rocket from anywhere. He could score from the point, and he could play defense like a demon.
Bobby Orr's got it as he's doing a bit of fancy stick handling between the two blue lines. Look at him go.
And if the usual ways, the expected moves didn't work, he created his own, in his own style, in his own way. On the ice, Bobby Orr was unmistakable, and unmistakably the best.
122.
Orr gets by Kelly. Across the line. Cuts in deep. Shot. Was almost upended as he cut it on Gamble. Busick controls. Gets it back to Orr. Orr cuts in. Stanfield in the corner, right out front. Puck
The Bruins won 57 games, tied 7, and lost only 14 as they captured the Eastern Division title in fine style. And Bobby Orr continued to raise the bar by rewriting the record book. As he surged to NHL records for most assists in the regular season, 102, and most points in the regular season, 139, by a defenseman. He also won the Hart Trophy as the most valuable player in the league for a second straight year, along with a 4th Norris Trophy as the premier defenseman and his 5th All-Star berth. But the Bruins exited the playoffs in the semifinals, a blow that did not sit well with Orr, the consummate team player.
He was almost behind that goal line, but somehow, some way, that puck went in behind Dryden on the feed from Kachanov.
As a team, we had an unbelievable season that following season, but then we went into the playoffs against the Canadiens, and they had some guy by the name of Dryden in net. And Kenny stood on his head in the series, and the Canadiens beat us in that series. But that was Ken's rookie year, and he was outstanding for the Canadiens. We think we outplayed the Canadiens, but Dryden in net, just, you know, we just couldn't get the puck by him.
On and off the ice, Bobby led by example. The spotlight was his because he deserved it, not because he craved it.
Bobby Orr never wanted the attention. If you look at him now in old clips, I mean, you know, see different guys today that score goals and they wrap their arms up and they go down on one leg and pump it or do whatever they do and high-five guys. But Bobby used to score goals and put his head down, just go back to the bench and say, let's get on with the game.
Bobby would be the leader out there in that ice continuum because he was on the ice more so than anybody else was. So everybody looked up to him.
Bobby wanted an answer to the loss of the Stanley Cup in 70-71, and he intended to provide it as the 71-72 season loomed.
We went into that season obviously upset from the year before, and we had one goal, and that was to be the champions again. And everyone, again, as a team, our team played very, very well that season, and we were rewarded at the end with the Stanley Cup.
Moving right in. If any single season can epitomize a career as outstanding as Bobby Orr's, it was that incredible 1971-72 season. After just missing hockey's holy grail the previous year, Orr marshaled his enormous talent, focused his intense pride, raised his capacity for leadership to new heights, and virtually carried the Bruins to success on the strength of his will.
You take the best shot from the point, the Jeff Brown slap shot in the Stanley Cup that Richter missed, that's Orr on a consistent basis. You take the player who handles the power play the best from the point and you say, that was Orr. And then you have one of the tough defensemen in the corner who doesn't take anything from any of the opposing forwards, that was Orr. Orr could go around the net, he could power behind the net and slide it in front, he could go around the net and do what a Pavel Bure does. I mean, I watch Pavel Bure circling the net in the Stanley Cup Finals, I say, there's a little Bobby Orr.
He controlled the whole game. He was a player that get the puck, and he was so smart, he could skate, he could shoot, he could score goals, and he could do anything. He was a good all-around hockey player.
I studied his movements for certain things that he would do. He would do something that would key me to do something else. And I'll never forget somebody, a very good friend of mine, who said to me, and she had never seen us play before. And the very first time she saw us play, I remember her saying to me, she says, boy, you and that number four out there really, really click.
Almost stolen by Dalvecchio. Esposito has a four-man rush to Orr. He's over the line.
Esposito and Orr were an on-ice marriage made in hockey heaven. There have been other great backline to frontline combinations. Harvey and Béliveau, Coffey and Gretzky, Bork and Neely, but none as prolific, as downright awesome, as undeniably great as Orr and Esposito. But then Orr made every Bruin into a scoring threat, an assist leader. Go up and down the Bruins roster in that memorable year, and look at the numbers for players like Derek Sanderson, Eddie Westfall, John McKenzie, Freddie Stanfield, the Chief, Johnny Busick, and the rest of that driven Bruins team, and you'll see what Orr meant to them all. He took them beyond themselves and into hockey history.
To Sanderson, now to Orr, breaking. Here comes Orr, right in. He shoots it! But now Orr breaks, delayed call, he's out to Walton. Orr heads for the net, Walton closes, fires, and misses. Rebound, score, Bobby Orr!
Now watch Bobby heading for the net. He's going to turn and come over to the right side just as Walton drives the puck. There he turns. Now watch this backhander. Right here in the top corner. How does he do it? I don't know.
Orr gets it. Picks up speed, leaves Monahan down the other end, and here he comes. Three men back. He's right by Brian Glennie. He cuts in. To Busick. The shot was saved by Bernie Perron. Pellick 2-on-1. McKinney trying to go in and stolen by Orr. Just took it off his stick. And Orr breaks. Cuts inside Lee. Still going to Kasprin and a save. Rebound. Puck loose. And it's tied up by Perrant. Orr controlling. Wheeling. Behind the net. A backhander. Esposito scores!
On the strength of Orr's superlative play, coupled to one of the most awesome offensive units ever seen in the NHL, the Bruins won the East Division with 119 points. Once again, Orr was the cream of the league, winning the Norris Trophy, the Hart Trophy, and his sixth consecutive All-Star selection. In the playoffs, Orr raised his exceptional game even higher, setting playoff records for assists and points by a defenseman and capturing the Conn Smythe Trophy as the outstanding playoff performer as he led the Bruins to their second Stanley Cup in 3 years.
If anything was a Bobby Orr Stanley Cup playoffs, it was 1972. And he was hurting, too, because I think he had an operation immediately following the playoffs. He dominated. He won the series against the New York Rangers, who were, you know, as I said, on the very same level as us.
Bobby, talking just a moment about yourself, and I know you don't like to do this, but it's got to be a tremendous series for you. I know you've had some problems with the knee, but congratulations are in order. You won the Conn Smythe Trophy. It's got to be a great, great series for you.
I feel fantastic. This year, that's what it's all about right there.
Are we getting the picture?
We got to have you stand right over
Cup
here.
In case you don't know what it is.
The Stanley Cup with Bobby Orr.
That's what it's all about.
Bobby, precisely, what about the knee, or can you comment on it now?
No, it just gets a little sore, and within the next couple of days, I'm going to see our doctors, and they're going to decide, and if they decide they're going to operate, they'll do it, I think, around the second week of June.
The 72-73 season was a year of almosts for the Bruins. They almost won the East Division, and they almost made it to the Stanley Cup semifinals. For Bobby Orr, it was a bittersweet year. As usual, he continued to rewrite hockey history on his way to a sixth straight Norris win and seventh straight All-Star appearance.
O'Reilly for Orr to Shepherd, and they break. Shepherd on the right side for Orr. Flip pass. He may break in. He's in. One-hander, and it rolls in. Just caught the corner. A one-hand goal by Bobby Orr.
Orr is way up. By now, even the most casual hockey fan knew the electricity that was Bobby Orr. Gearing up in his own end at the beginning of a nice long rush to glory that always showed a new dimension to his seemingly endless skills. Or diffusing a dangerous opposition rush with a casual flick of his stick, or a courageous headlong dive in front of a 90-mile-an-hour puck. For Bobby, there was only one way to play the game, and that was flat out all the time. And for those of us who saw him play, well, the usual fan's fantasy of imagining yourself out there on the ice making those moves, scoring those heroic goals, that didn't work with Bobby. He was just too good for our imaginations to contain.
Swoops in front. Nice shift. Over to Busek. Busek scores! Orr fights for it behind the net. Has it. Looking in front. Wheels in front. Locked on the pass. Has it again. Orr cuts around. A backhander. Scores! Off the post! Plant stops it behind the net for Orr. Orr with Gould there. Tries it on an empty net. Push around, and it is a score. A racket. He fired that from behind the goal line. I didn't see Crozier out of the net, but Orr did, and he didn't miss. Orr. In by Clancy. Scores right through the pads of Gordon McRae, and it's 1-1. Shorthanded. Here he is, cutting in with Esposito. Whipping on the side, and he scores! Bobby Orr! Shorthanded goal to tie it up. What a Bobby Orr goal!
Here comes Orr up the middle. Over the line, trying to go in. He does! He scores! What a goal! For a hat trick, Bobby Orr, his 100th point!
Orr with a fantastic move. Bobby Orr can do it all. He's gotten 3 goals tonight for his 100th point.
Sanderson, Hodge, Busek, Stanfield, and Orr. Orr, a drive, score! The deflection of Tim Hodge. Orr is back. Park goes for the shot, save. Gets the second one. What a stop by Bobby Orr! You've never seen anything like that. He covered behind Plant.
Brad Park got the original drive. He picked up his own rebound. Jock went down. Park drew it around him. He had the open net. You watch it here.
But in that almost season of 1972-73, Bobby's beloved Bruins didn't get to sip champagne from Lord Stanley's famous mug. And to Orr, personal honors were no replacement for team success.
The team we had, we really should have won more Stanley Cups. And in 72, after that 72 win, the WHA began playing, and in a year we lose Cheevers, McKenzie, Sanderson, and you know, to be a winner, to be successful, you've got to have a lot of good players, a lot of hard-working players, and those three players leaving us really hurt. It hurt us big time.
Just kept it in. Holds his shot.
The 73-74 season was a season of highs and lows for Boston and Orr. The Bruins once more reigned as East Division champions. Phil Esposito won his fifth scoring title with Bobby right behind. And Bobby was again named the league's outstanding defenseman and an all-star.
Tie it up. Phil Esposito's 400th career goal. Esposito playing the point.
Think of the greatest athletes in other sports. Michael Jordan, Mickey Mantle, Muhammad Ali, Rod Laver, Jack Nicklaus, Joe Montana. There's no need to even mention which sport they played or catalog their accomplishments. Everybody just knows. Because what they are and what they've done transcends their sport. Every sport.
Now to Esposito on the right side over the line. Drops it for Orr. Orr holding. Fires. As he tees this one up.
Bobby Orr was the greatest athlete ever to play hockey. He redefined the game in his own terms. He transcended the limits of a game drawn to contain mere mortals. And his name grew beyond hockey into the realm of the truly legendary heroes of sport.
And you gotta give a little pat on the back to Derek Sanderson. He made a great shift at the blue line, taking out the left side of that. Here's the play by Orr, who makes the great defensive play and then turns it into offense. Now watch Sanderson right here. He took out that left defenseman of Buffalo, giving Orr the opportunity to pass it over and cut in between. Marcotte with a beautiful pass. That's beautiful timing. And Orr just redirected it in behind Dryden. A beautiful goal.
Adelson gets it back to Orr, though. The right point.
Shot.
But sometimes even Bobby Orr had to be lucky to be good.
It hit a broken stick and hit Daly and went in.
Well, it wasn't a hard shot when it started out, but when it reached that net, it wasn't even, you could almost read the label.
Moves in front.
In 1973-74, the highs for Bobby Orr included a fifth straight season of more than 100 scoring points and a team record of 52 wins, 17 losses, and 9 ties in the regular season.
Over to Orr, both clubs shorthanded. Orr over the line by Harris, moving, drives, scores, Bobby Orr!
Now starts out, gets by Bobby Hall, and now retreats again. 17 seconds. Fakes one way, goes to the left, wheels again, killing off the clock. 10 seconds left.
Orr starts it out, checked by Holmes. Shifts to Marcotte, has it, is in.
By this point in his career, those special Bobby Orr moves were being recognized by fans and fellow stars alike.
Passes to Hodge, back to Orr, in tight, scores! It's 6-5.
That was one of the patent moves Bobby made when you come up and think you had him, and you reach for it and he's going out the other side, you whoops, excuse me, and you have to, then you're in hot pursuit after him. But it was a, he brought a new, like the new dimension. He was basically the fourth forward is what he was, and that's the guy that's the most dangerous.
The low that year came in the Stanley Cup final, but in the first round against Toronto, the Bruin Magic was plain to see and impossible to beat as the Leafs bowed out in four straight.
Orr fires, scores, Bobby Orr! Broken up by Bill White. Puck loose, Hodge knocks right down to Cashman behind the net. Back for Orr, holds it to Phil Esposito.
Then, Orr took his team against Chicago, and it was goodnight Blackhawks, 4-2.
An open net goal, and it looked almost easy for Boston there, as Phil Esposito was set up by Orr.
Here he comes. In for Deason.
In the championship round, the Bruins met the Philadelphia Flyers. Boston was heavily favored, but the Broad Street Bullies upset the Bruins 4-2 on the exceptional goaltending of Bernie Parent to capture the title.
from him. Gets it up on the left wing to Busick. Busick to center.
Even Orr's brilliance at both ends of the rink could not pierce the impenetrable shade Bernie Parent cast around the Phillies' net. He led his team with 3 goals and 4 assists and did everything within his considerable power to take the cup back to Boston one more time.
Unbelievable on this one.
Takes a hard hit and is flattened by Andre Dupont. He hauls Dupont down. Hodge goes in. Back to Orr. Quick shot.
Bobby Orr! With 22 seconds left! Bobby Orr! That's the job! 2-on-1, Clayton back alone. Here's Orr. Over to Shepard. Back to Orr. Shepard scores! As Bobby Orr made a brilliant play. A short-handed goal to Orr. 2-on-1 with spots for the moment. 2-on-2 with Shepard. In for Shepard. Hit the post. Orr the backhand. Scores! Bobby Orr! On the rebound of the Shepard shot. And the Bruins lead it 2-1. And the Bobby Orr backhander.
But it was not to be. Even legends sometimes meet their match. And the 1973-74 final was a match for the ages.
And players are falling all over the place as the tension really mounts here in the Spectrum. Here's a chance for Kitty Hart. It's all over. And we have 19 seconds remaining. Here's the place. And here's the driver. 14 seconds. Still do there. Shot it to an open win.
The Philadelphia Flyers were a very good hockey team, led by Bobby Clark, who could play on any of my teams. Bobby was a fine hockey player with Perrant and net. And coaching. Fred Giroux did a great job with that team. They went into the series with a plan. They stuck to the plan. They didn't waver from it. And they just played a very, very solid series.
Well, I know as we review your career, there have been tremendous moments, and I know you'll cherish them forever. One moment was the arrival of Don Cherry as a coach to the Boston Bruins. What happened?
The highlight of my career. Don was playing for you.
What about
Don, half the battle is getting your players to want to play for you, and the players wanted to play for Don Cherry. They loved Don. I think Don knows a little more about the game than he lets on. I think he knows a whole lot more about the game than he lets on. But the key was that Don Cherry loved his players, and the players loved Don, and they wanted to play for him.
With Don Cherry prominently on the scene and a powerful Bruins lineup looking for revenge, 74-75 promised to be a very interesting season. But this was not the first time Don had seen Bobby, and their previous introduction had been a revelation.
When I was playing in the American Hockey League, I never really saw Bobby Orr play in person. And I really detested the guy. I got to be truthful, because I was a big, slow-moving defenseman, and here comes this guy flying all over the ice, and I thought, this guy can't be a hockey player getting all these points. How could he be a defenseman? So I went down for a morning skate, and there was Bobby Orr. I couldn't believe it. It was like when Sonny Fitzsimmons, the old horse trainer, saw Secretariat. He couldn't believe it. I looked at him. This was the ultimate in a hockey player. I never knew someday I was going to be lucky enough to coach him.
Don Cherry knew that he had a very special talent on his team, and like every hockey fan, he loved to watch that talent soar.
I was coach of the Bruins. In other words, I opened and closed the door for Bobby Orr. Now, I'm going to tell you the greatest story of a goal nobody knows about. It was scored in Oakland, of all places, Oakland. What happened was Bobby was killing a penalty. And you know how he used to go behind the net, go out, back, and go. If you chase him, he'd go out in front again. Well, this time he was doing his magic, true story, whirled around, skated down the right side, whistled it in the top corner. Good save by Gary Smith, remember Suitcase Smith? In like that, as he's behind the net, he whacked it out of the air into the top corner. It's the first time in the history of hockey both teams give a standing ovation.
Or rushing.
The 74-75 season was to rank as one of Bobby Orr's best. He scored 46 goals and registered 89 assists to win the Art Ross Trophy and set an NHL record for goals in a regular season by a defenseman. And as usual, he won the Norris Trophy and an All-Star berth.
Puck loose goes to Jerry Hart of the Islanders. Boston leads 1-0. Halfway through the first period, Stolemaier, he's in!
Sometimes with certain athletes, it seems as though the world waits for them.
And this is John Lemieux.
Waits to see what magic they'll spin next.
Forbes right in.
Waits to be surprised and amazed by the best move ever until the next one comes along.
Allman a shot, and a save!
Waits for that defining moment when we can turn to each other and say, that was when he won the game. That was the turning point. Bobby Orr never let anyone wait for long, but his effortless style, his unnatural ability to take over a game, to make it his, to make it come out his way, set a standard for hockey players that has us all still waiting for the next Bobby Orr.
57 seconds left in the penalty to draw to Orr. Quick shot, score! Bobby Orr off the faceoff, and the draw by Phil Esposito right back to him, into the corner, power play goal by Bobby Orr.
Well, point number 108 for both Orr and Esposito. They tied for the league scoring, but these faceoffs, very important. Esposito won this cleanly. Back to Orr, and he really blasted that one.
And it goes into Gilbert, Orr, trying to drive it around, and struck Wicks. Bounces for Brian Hextall. Stolen by Orr. Orr clears, and that's not icing, and it is a goal! Bobby Orr with 8 seconds left. He's a marksman from anywhere. 250 career goals for Bobby Orr, his 37th, and the Bruins lead 4-2. Now Esposito, Busek, Schmatz, the draw to Orr. Turns, fires, scores!
Bobby Orr from Phil Esposito, just like that. The 251st for Orr, but his 38th goal this season. And that is a new record in the NHL, held formerly by Bobby Orr.
Sanderson out for his time as Orr rushes.
Right inside Marat, and is Orr in, one-hander, and a save, score, Kasman on the rebound.
Wilson looking at the empty net, the backhander blocked by Orr. Controlled again by Wilson, and that should do it. Another shot by Wilson, and a save by Orr with his stick. He just got a piece of Ellis, and I tell you, if he hits him, they'll feel it. Lead pass in for Orr, deflects to Orr, he's in, and he scores! Bobby Orr!
With a break in on a deflected pass, broken alone on McRae, drew him out and put in the backhander, and it's 1-0 ball.
The best acknowledged the best, and to Larry Robinson, Bobby Orr was in a league of his own.
Evan Cornway, who many considered, you know, one of the fastest skaters in the league, was alone at the blue line, and Bobby was coming back, and he was about at the red line, and he caught Evan before he got to the net. And it was then and there that I realized just what a, you know, a tremendous athlete, what a tremendous skater he was.
I think that overall, an indication of what a great playmaker he was as a defenseman, he had over 600 assists.
The 74-75 season was terrific for Bobby, but like the hero Achilles, Bobby's greatest years were about to be cut short by a physical problem, and it stemmed from his incredible courage.
He always kept himself in superb physical condition. He played around 195 to 200 pounds, and but he went where angels feared to tread. If Orr needed to go into the corner to get the puck, he went into the corner and got the puck. And he played the game with reckless abandon and consequently shortened his career. Marcel Pronovost hit him in Maple Leaf Gardens. That was the first knee injury. The same thing happens when Orr's coming out of his own zone with Pat Quinn coming the other way.
Britt Selby, who was a member of our team at that time, had come across and put Bobby on an angle outside towards the boards. And as a defenseman, I saw that he had no place to go and saw an opportunity to make some contact with Bob, so I stepped up and caught him just inside his blue line with what I believe was a shoulder check. Unfortunately, I hit Bob hard in the chin and knocked him unconscious.
My head was down, and it was another Leaf player when I'm trying to kick the puck up the boards, and Patty came across, and he just And when I dropped my head, the height I was at, and Patty's a big guy, and he charged a little bit. But if I had been standing up and my head hadn't been so close to the board and so on, I probably wouldn't have even been hurt. And he might have got a 2-minute penalty. But Pat Quinn isn't a player that wants to hurt guys. I mean, he'd hit guys, and he's a big man.
It takes a tremendous amount of courage to play hockey. Bobby had a tremendously high pain tolerance, and he was not afraid of situations. He would go in. That's why he got injured. He would drive to the net injured. He would drive to the net hurt. He played that way every night.
Bobby Orr.
Orr paid a steep price for being the best. He was the guy other teams keyed on. He was the guy with a target on his chest. Stop Bobby and you stop the Bruins. That's what they said. And sometimes that's what they did. Hockey is a tough sport. Hockey players expect to hit and be hit. Orr took his share, maybe more than his share, and always came back for more. He played hurt. He played in constant pain. But he never stopped playing like Bobby Orr. And that, too, is the mark of greatness.
Bobby had the bad knee for a lot of years. And he was told. We used to tell him, Bobby, take it easy. Can't. I don't know how.
You know, people would say to me, gosh, they're trying to hurt you. Hockey is a tough game, and hockey is a contact game. And when you play like I played, like to carry the puck, and that the guy that has the puck, that's the player that they're going to key on. And when you carry the puck a lot in a contact game, you're going to be hit a lot. And I was hit a lot, but that was my own fault. And, you know, I had a bad knee, so my style certainly didn't help my problem.
Bobby continued to play his own inimitable, flat-out, crowd-pleasing style. But the good nights were getting harder to come by. His knees were causing woes that only he could describe, but he never did. He never used them as an excuse. Injuries kept him out of many games over the next few seasons, but they couldn't keep him from one final glorious hurrah in 1976.
I'd never played for my country in international hockey, and in 76, finally getting an opportunity to play for Canada in the Canada Cup, obviously, was a highlight, something I'll always remember, so it's one of the highlights of my career. Winning the Canada Cup, it's right up there with the Stanley Cup, no question about it. No question.
I was very fortunate in 76 in the Canada Cup to have Bobby as my defense partner, and I don't know the pain that he went through, but I realize that what a tremendous athlete he was and a competitor in that, he was in such pain that he couldn't even practice between games. And after every game, there was 6-8 ice packs around his knees. And yet, probably one of the most difficult men I've ever had to play with because he was so smart. You never knew what he was going to do. So I just give it to him and let him go.
Orr hits the line.
His damaged knees had kept Orr out of the 72 Soviet series, but he made up for it in the 76 Canada Cup, winning the tournament's most valuable player award. As it turned out, this was the last time fans would get to see Orr at the top of his game.
He knew that inevitably that was going to come to an end. And I think he knew in the Canada Cup of 76, when he played so masterfully, that, you know, there was just so much juice left in that leg, and there wasn't a lot left now.
I remember him playing for Chicago, and I was with the Rangers. He was in pain. You could see it on the ice. He was still as good as anybody on the ice, by the way. But you could see he was in tremendous pain. And, you know, like you always try to do, you try to take advantage of that. And, you know, the thought was throw it in his corner and make him turn to the, so on his bad knee and try to hit him and all that other stuff. And that bothered me a lot.
After the Canada Cup, Bobby continued to play, when his terribly banged up knees allowed, for Boston and later Chicago. But the days of soaring majesty were behind him, and his injuries finally forced him to retire.
I'm very, very happy that I attempted to play again. I now know for sure that my leg cannot handle
playing. I'm disappointed, but I am relieved. I would not want to go through the rest of my life thinking, well, maybe there was that chance. I now know I'm no longer able to play.
I just know that it's a very, very unfortunate that we lost a player of the stature of Bobby Orr due to a knee injury, because we get robbed of some of the finest hockey we would see. We've seen a lot of great hockey from him, but I feel we got robbed of a lot more that Bobby would have gave to our game.
I took a couple of years to really finally say, hey, it's over. And I took that time because I wanted it very clear in my mind that I couldn't play. And, you know, when I went to Chicago, I played 10 games, whatever it was. My knee really started to bother me, and I took a long period off. I took the year off. Sometimes, you know, time is the best healer. So I took it off, then I came back the following year to try to play again. And it just wasn't going to work. So I knew then that I just couldn't play, and it was time to make that announcement. Even knowing that I couldn't play, it was still obviously very difficult. It's something I'd done all my life. And I think the thing that scared me most of all was, God, I've got to go to work. The business world, what do I do? And that frightened the heck out of me. That really did frighten the heck out of me. But it was, all of a sudden, you know, they're taking your skates from you, and you can't do what you've done your entire life. And I made a very serious mistake playing, that I didn't take time to learn any other business. That's another thing when talking to young players today. We had lots of time. You know, free time, there was plenty of it. And I just didn't take that free time and use it properly. It was hockey, 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 hockey. And this is not a criticism of the game or the people in hockey, but with all that free time, I should have been taking it and learning something else. But I didn't do it. Now at 29, I'm finished. What do I do? And it was frightening. That's the best way to put it. I was frightened. And I was very lucky. I had some wonderful people, wonderful friends who supported me and were patient with me. And things have worked out very well.
In 1979, shortly after he retired, Bobby Orr was inducted into the Hockey Hall of Fame, and his famous number 4 sweater was retired by the Bruins. Bobby was supernatural on the ice and wonderful off it. The rewards and accolades he received as a player have followed him into retirement.
Finished writing my memoir, and I have a chapter on Bobby, exactly on that. And the editor asked me, why do you have a chapter on Bobby and maybe on not some other guy like Maurice Richard or Gordie Howe? And well, I said exactly because I think to me Bobby Orr changed the game. That's the greatest change in the game, is the mobility of defensemen.
What a terrific person, both on and let's not forget off the ice.
He's extremely intense. He's a perfectionist. He's very sensitive. He's, for as exposed as he has been to the media, he's very shy. And he's always very, very aware of doing the right thing. He's a tremendous role model. He's something that I would like to, you know, model, have my sons look up to.
You have an exceptional defenseman on your team, right away they make comparisons. Well, this is another Bobby Orr. And I think there'll only be one Bobby Orr, the same as there'll only be one Wayne Gretzky and one Mario Lemieux. And I think that's the best way to leave it, is that he's one of a kind.
To me, he's been the best athlete that I played against, and maybe should be rated as the best ever to play.
He's a better person than a hockey player. A better person than a hockey player.
A great example to the kids even as of today, and he's a great ambassador to hockey.
In the game today, Bobby would still be number one. He would be the best defenseman in the National Hockey League. I have no doubt in that in my mind. From playing with him and from watching the players now, he would be right on top.
He had a passion and a love for the game
that allowed all of these qualities and all these skills and talents to come out.
The greatest hockey player who ever lived, Bobby Orr, and I love him.
I've always made this statement, and that is that if somebody greater than Robert Orr comes along, I hope the good Lord sees fit to keep me on this earth, because he's really going to be something else.
Bobby Orr was complete as a hockey player and as a person. On the ice, his artistry and incredible talent thrilled us for too short a time. But what he did and the way he did it picked up the game of hockey and shook it to its core, changing it forever and for the better. We may never see his like again. Number 4, Bobby Orr was the best.